Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we praise and worship you for your goodness, love, and mercy. As creator of the world, you gave us life and breath. As preserver of all life, you provide for us day by day. As redeemer of all mankind, you show us your love in Christ. We praise you that the Lord is King and his Spirit has been poured into our hearts. In Christ, we join the heavenly host to praise, to worship, and to adore. Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, praise be to your name, O Lord Most High. Amen.
Can be found in Paul's letter to the Philippians, chapter 4, starting to read at verse 4. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. Praise my soul, the King of heaven. To his feet your tributes bring. Ransomed, healed, restored, forgiven. Who like me? His praise should sing. I wonder, Do you recognise those words? They came from the first hymn you may have sung along as we started our worship this morning. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. How about these words? You've heard them from our reading offered to us this morning. And if you stop and think about it, there are loads of things rejoice in. Take a look at these slides, for instance. Cup of coffee. Some people like coffee. It makes them happy. And then some would get the same effect from tea. This is a good one. When you have had a very busy day, there's nothing makes you happier than crawling into a nice warm bed. A book. Finishing a good book can sometimes make you feel happy and content. Or a call from a long lost friend, and the smile and the way it makes you feel when you speak to them yet again. And this one, hugging someone or something you really love can bring a smile to your face, makes your heart happy if you like. Oh, and how about this, watching all the football, or if the Euro's not your thing, the alternative on offer are loads of Star Wars films. This may upset you, but how many Sundays till Christmas? It could be an important comment, which just may make someone happy, some people joyful and happy, you know. And I'd like you to think of those few different ideas. And I feel, thinking about them, we can safely say the word rejoice means different things to different people. A dictionary definition of the word says to feel joyful is to be delighted, and lots of things cause us to be delighted. The words you heard from our Bible are given to us by the Apostle Paul, as he had given them to the people in Philippi, who, as far as he was concerned, had lots to be joyful about. He was responsible for introducing the people there to the good news of Jesus Christ. So, this letter is the 11th book in the New Testament to the Christian congregation he had established in Philippi. History tells us that when Paul sent this letter, he was lying in prison with almost certain death awaiting him. He was imprisoned for preaching the gospel of Christ, yet he was able to set out in this letter that the Christian way was a cause for rejoicing. He so wanted to tell them and us that faith in Christ is the foundation for joy and hope in life, as well as in death. It's only a short letter and it's worth a read. Knowing the situation Paul was in, it certainly gives us words of hope that Jesus is right there with us in everything. And there's no getting away from it. Jesus' life on earth, all that he showed us, all that he did for us, without doubt, is the cornerstone of the Christian faith. And this Bible teaches us that Jesus came into the world, entered human suffering, and conquered sin and death. Only through faith in Jesus Christ can we persevere and sustain our hope and joy. You see, they had just begun their Christian walk, a walk which in those days would have been filled with loads of danger and persecution. Today, here in Whiston, at any rate anyway, we can worship together in freedom. This morning in our church, children have been baptised. They've been placed at the start of their Christian journey. And as church, we've welcomed them into the fellowship of faith, a faith which is built on the truths we read of in our Bibles. Of course, these children's families and friends come from many different places, and as a worshipping congregation, we don't always know everyone who comes to celebrate the baptism of those children on that day. But we do know we can rejoice, pray for, and support them on the promises they have made before God. The Bible gives us reason to rejoice. We rejoice because God showed his love and grace to us. We have reason to celebrate because God is in control. We should rejoice because God is good and his love endures forever. We must learn to rejoice in the Lord always, even in our darkest moments, even when we don't know what way to turn. We are called to remember all that Jesus did for us and rejoice. Paul was in a mess, to put it mildly, and yes, it can be hard to even comprehend how he could possibly write the words he did to give us the hope we can have in Christ in the good times and the bad times. Christ is with us even when we don't notice it. You also heard Paul give those people some very good advice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. Then finally, he said, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. Now, I always think that Paul was addressing people who'd just begun their Christian walk then, and is doing the same to us every day of our lives. There's a book in the Bible said to be one of the shortest Old Testament books, a book of prophets' words. Words proclaimed by Sophina, the prophet. As with all the prophets, his book is filled with words of warning and words of hope for the people of God, if only they will turn back to him. In it, at chapter 3, verse 17, you find these words. The Lord your God is with you, the mighty warrior who saves. He will take great delight in you. In his love, he will no longer rebuke you, but will rejoice over you with singing. Yes, the Lord your God is certainly rejoicing over you today and always into the future. Rejoice in the Lord always. I'll say it again. Rejoice. Amen.
Thank you.
We just take a few moments now to bring before God anything that we particularly want to pray for today. And we say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and for ever. Amen. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him. so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. And the blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen.